Good morning, Nevada and all our neighboring states. I'm Peter Lycopoulos, and this is the March 30th, 2013 edition of Rural Nevada Today, brought to you by the Dairy Farmers of Southern Nevada. Well, happy Easter, everybody, and to our Jewish friends, I hope you had a wonderful Passover. I hope that this holiest of seasons finds you and your family with a great amount of peace and joy, and may you stay in peace, may we all stay in peace this whole year. At least it's a thought. However, each of us should take the time to practice our faith in this holiest time of the year. Don't be embarrassed by your faith. Don't be embarrassed by showing it. You know, much is said about Christmas and Easter churchgoers. Well, you know, perhaps it's a start. Who knows? You can go to church and realize just how peaceful the rest of your day is. You might want to start going back for more. Now, you know what? Last week, we read an editorial by Sherman Fredericks on Harry Reid. Well, you know what? Last Saturday at home, he's got another piece, and he asked the question, who's the bigger idiot, Harry Reid or Joe Biden? This after Joe Biden stated that Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords had been mortally wounded, which, folks, means that she's dead. Obviously, she's not dead. So we're going to have a little fun with this question. We're going to take an unscientific survey, and just for a little bit of comic relief this morning, give me a call and tell me who your favorite idiot is. Is it Harry or is it Joe? Who knows? Just give us a call at 257-5396. Now, in this part of the show, where I normally go on and on and on, we are going to have a very brief part because I think this morning, with everything that's going on, we need to step back and take a look at a historical perspective. You always have the liberals coming up and saying, hey, you know, the forefathers, they could not visualize automatic weapons. They couldn't visualize all the different things that we have today. You know, we were only talking about a muzzleloader. Well, back in the 1770s, that was the assault weapon. And today, I got a great piece that comes out, and it's how the American Revolution started. Now, on Monday, we got a new sponsor coming on to the show. Daryl and I had met for lunch, and we talked about wanting to do this commercial. And we'll be talking about these fellows. It's the Barrel Company. We're going to talk about them a little bit later on. And we started talking about the American Revolution. And, well, you know, you got the Boston Tea Party in 1773 to protest the Tea Stamp Act. And, of course, there was the ever-popular No Taxation Without Representation. But what really got the colonists' shorts in a bunch and started them with a shooting war happened in 1774. You had a import ban on firearms and gunpowder, led, followed by a confiscation of firearms and gunpowder later on in 1774 and in 1775. But like I say, you listen to what I've got to read, and it's going to be a historical lesson today. Read it. Listen to it. Tell me what you think is going on with our country, and you tell me if this doesn't ring true with what is going on today. And when you listen to these people who get on the air and tell you that our forefathers had no idea of what was going to happen in the future. No, they had it. And we're going to be talking about this. Now, I'm not going to be doing a lot of extra things this morning, but I tell you what, I just could not let this go. Here's a great dilemma for the left. What's more important, green energy or the Golden Eagles? Now, a single Golden Eagle could spell trouble for White Pine County Wind Farm that sells power to NV Energy. U.S. Fish and Wildlife was conducting an investigation after a Golden Eagle was killed in late February on Spring Valley Wind Farm, about 300 miles north of Las Vegas. They did all the things that they were supposed to do, but you've got an eagle that's dead. And this comes from a spokeswoman from U.S. Fish and Wildlife. Even so, even though that the wind farm did everything that they could do, you can't control these birds flying into these windmills. They may face up to a $200,000 fine. A $200,000 fine. Now, that fine could have been mitigated if they would have purchased a take permit that would allow them to accidentally kill a golden or bald eagle. Sounds a whole lot like the desert tortoise. Remember, I fought this when I was a commissioner in Nye County. They wanted $500 an acre. If the construction company or if the developer paid $500 per acre, you can do whatever you want with the desert tortoise. They really didn't care anything about the desert tortoise. It was just a tax. That is the same thing. Can you believe this? If they bought this take permit, they wouldn't be getting fined. I've got nothing against solar energy, wind energy. I think that should all be developed. But there's a few things that you got to take a look at. Fossil fuels and atomic energy are going to be your best energy for years to come. While solar and wind, that's an augmentation. You're never going to be putting on a windmill or a solar panel onto a ship, an airplane, or an automobile to power it. It's always going to need some type of fossil fuel or atomic energy. We've had atomic subs since World War II. Think about that. But here you do. What do you do? What do you do if you're a leftist environmentalist? Unbelievable. Well, I'll tell you what. You can give us a call at 257-5396. That phone number again is 702-257-5396. And now it's time for your live gold-silver market report at the close of business Friday, March 29, 2013. Gold closed for $1,600.10, making for a $13 decrease from last week. Last week, it increased by $12.70. Now, gold has stayed level, pretty much absolutely level, just popping up and down for the past 6 weeks. Silver closed at $28.40 an ounce, making for a 74-cent decrease over last week. This week's live silver and gold market report was brought to us by the Dairy Farmers of Southern Nevada.
Jumping on a trampoline can leave you thirsty, but most drinks out there are high in calories and low in vitamins and minerals and lack a very important thing. The power behind the play. Milk from your local dairyman gives you that power. Low-fat and fat-free milk are naturally nutrient-rich, keeping you healthy and fit. So after all that jumping, ask for quality, icy-cold local milk from your local dairyman. It's the power behind the play. Visit DairyCouncilUTNV.org.
Well, welcome back to the show. It's contest time, and what I need to know for the four tickets to the Mob Connection, which of our founding fathers had an illegitimate son who became a colonial governor of New Jersey? He stayed a loyalist and later died in England. After the Revolution, he went to England. So what was that founding father who had an illegitimate son who became the colonial governor of New Jersey and stayed a loyalist, completely opposite of his father, stayed a loyalist and ended up dying in England? Give us a call at 702-257-5396.
Nestled on the Nevada-California border in the Sandy Valley sits Two Hawk Ranch. Surrounded by thick, lush fields of locally grown alfalfa, Two Hawk Ranch has bulk and cubes available. If you have not tried alfalfa cubes, let the good folks at Two Hawk Ranch explain to you the value of feeding your horses cubes, and you decide which of these great products you wish to feed your animal. Horse and livestock owners, with a great supply of locally grown alfalfa, where you can buy direct from the owner, why would you buy from anyone else? Call Jared or Kale at 702-723-5375. That number again, 702-723-5375. Or drive out the Sandy Valley and follow the signs. You'll be able to see the green fields of Two Hawk Ranch long before you get there. Two Hawk Ranch, they'll always treat you right.
I like baseball. I love milk. My milk's low in calories and high in vitamins and minerals. My milk comes from cows in beautiful Nevada. Cows and milk are the power behind the play.
Icy cold local milk from your local dairyman gives you that power. Low-fat and fat-free milk are naturally nutrient-rich.
Baseball and milk keep me healthy and fit.
Quality, icy cold local milk from your local dairyman.
The power behind the play.
The phone lines are open. Call Peter now at 702-257-5396.
Well, welcome back to the show. And I got a question for you. I want to know which of our founding fathers had an illegitimate son who became the colonial governor of New Jersey, stayed a loyalist, and later died in England. Give us a call at 257-5396. That number again is 257-5396. Caller line one, you're on the air.
Good morning.
How you doing today?
Doing pretty good. Was it T.J. Thomas Jefferson?
Nope, it wasn't Thomas Jefferson.
All right, thanks.
Hey, have a great day. Take care now. Caller line two, you're on the air.
Was it Governor Robert Morris?
Nope, it wasn't Governor Robert Morris.
Thank you.
Hey, have a great day. So give us a call, 257-5396. Who was the illegitimate, what founding father had an illegitimate son that stayed a loyalist?
You still using that beat-up old piece of firewood?
The Green Hornet's caught more fish than you've lied about, Gustafson.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what, that lets me know that we've had a fishing report this morning. Now, at Lake Mead, striper action has definitely picked up over the last couple of weeks. Anglers are reporting catching fish as large as 20 pounds, and many are coming in at 8 to 12-pound range. Now, gizzard shads plus various plugs are catching fish. Most of the activity is being found throughout the lower basin, especially in that area from Saddle Island to Las Vegas Wash. Now, at Lake Mojave, the bite for largemouth and smallmouth bass doing pretty good. With the fish in a spawning mole, they're saying baits are working near rocks and stumps in the shallow areas because they're in shallow. And they're yielding some hits. Now, in a strange twist, one lucky angler caught a near Willow Beach. This is not a strange twist. This is most ridiculous. It comes every time, and it's at mile marker 52. We talk about this every week. They go out, they drop in the trout. It's like chumming for the large stripers. Lucky twist, it happens every week. 28-pound striper was caught. How about that? That's out at Lake Mojave. But it does happen every week, folks. Mile marker is like from 48 to 54. Get in there. There's always some large fish. Okay, we got a caller. Caller line one, you're on the air.
Yeah, was it Ben Franklin?
It absolutely was Ben Franklin. He was out there, and his son, William Franklin, stayed a loyalist. So I'll tell you what, if you will, hold on, and Jim will get your name, phone number, and address off the air, and I'll get these tickets mailed out to you.
He almost died in America. You know, colonists tried to hang him, and Ben talked them off the gallows and let him go.
Yeah, and you know what? As long as I got, and I forgot to ask the first two, who do you think is the bigger idiot? We got to do this on scientific poll. Would you go with Joe Biden or Harry Reid?
Who is the bigger what?
Who is the bigger idiot, Joe Biden or Harry Reid? Frederick Sherman had asked this question.
It's close to a draw, but I'd give Harry Reid the nod due to his comments about the seven Marines that died last week.
And of course, he is the Nevada favorite son, so he could have a little favorite son action going here.
Yeah.
Okay, hold on, and we'll get this taken care of, all right?
Hey, you got it. Thank you very much.
Thanks, and have a wonderful day. Now, at the Urban Ponds, despite the windy, cooler conditions, Urban Ponds are receiving significant pressure from hopeful anglers. Kids are off of school, folks. Recent days, trout seem to be liking the yellow power eggs and the mealworms. Now, warm water fish such as the bluegill and the bass are starting to hit as the water temperature increases, and you're also getting the spawning area in the little ponds just like you are in the bigger lakes. Up at Nye County, Kirsch Wildlife Management Area, Dacy is producing rainbow trout between the 12 and 16-inch length. Now, fish are biting on both flies and spinners. Cold Springs and Hay Meadow are producing smaller rainbows, but the action is, it's been pretty fast. They're catching a lot of fish up there. Now, fish access in Adams is not a problem for boaters, float tubers, and shore anglers. The upper end, don't forget, they're closed. Now, the upper end of that Dacy area, and they do this every year from February 15th to August 15th, it is closed. Now, Dacy's artificial lures only, and one trout per day may be taken out of that area. Campgrounds are still, you know, the water is still turned off at this time. Now, if you're going to head out to Lincoln County, Eagle Valley Reservoir, fishing continues to pick up over the past week. Most anglers are catching rainbow trout in the 12 to 15-inch range, and they're using a variety of spinners, such as Mepster, Castmasters. You also, and the campgrounds are open when the water will be turned on. Out at Echo Canyon, fishing near the dam is especially good. One pair of anglers caught and released 40 trout in a couple hours. They were using those small nets. Fish are averaging between 11 and 13 inches. The campground is open. Now, here's something. You're going to hear it today, then you're going to see it in the paper tomorrow. Call Monday or you're going to lose out on this. You got a free class. These classes go quick. This is a free fishing class. The Department of Wildlife is going to hold this on Saturday, which in a couple of weeks, 2 weeks from now, Saturday the 13th at Floyd Lamb Park. They're located at Durango on Highway 95 in the northern part of the valley. The clinic is going to be open up to all anglers, anglers of all ages. It'll start at 9 o'clock, and our volunteers are going to teach some of your fish basics, how to choose bait, lures, casting techniques. Going to be a great thing. A Nevada fishing license is required for anybody who is 21 or older. Register by calling Ivy Santine at 486-5127. That's 486-5127, and it's extension 3503. I would do that first thing Monday morning if you are thinking about anything but getting into this. This is great. Now, I got another question for you, our second question, and this is for the pocket knife. What was the last battle of the Revolutionary War? Give me a call at 257-5396. And as always, this week's Fishing Report was brought to us by Cool Radiator.
Is your car's radiator leaking? Does your cooling system need some attention? And with this economy, have you been putting it off? Not doing routine maintenance can end up costing you many more dollars down the road. So if it's been a while since you've had your car's cooling system serviced, or if you're looking for a real radiator shop that can answer your questions, then it's time to stop by Cool Radiator at 3228 West Mead Avenue and let Daryl have a look at your radiator. Daryl will be able to answer all of your questions and explain just how your cooling system works. The good folks at Cool Radiator understand your concerns, and they can help. So stop stressing out and stop by Cool Radiator and get some of the small problems fixed before they turn into something major. That's Cool Radiator at 3228 West Mead Avenue, east of Valley View, between Sahara and Dion.
The phone lines are open. Call Peter now at 702-257-5396.
Well, welcome back to the show. Now, I need to know who or what was the last battle in the Revolutionary War? Give us a call at 257-5396. That phone number again is 257-5396. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead, caller.
Yeah, was it Yorktown?
It sure was. It was the Battle of Yorktown in 1781. And that was it. That was what ended the war. Now, do you know where Cool Radiator is?
Thank you.
All right, do you know where Cool Radiator is?
Yes, I do.
Walk in, tell Daryl you won.
Thank you.
You have a wonderful day.
Thank you very much.
Take care,
though. See you every Saturday.
Okay. Hey, by the way, sir.
Uh-huh.
Your favorite idiot.
Joe Biden.
Which is the bigger idiot? I got to notice. We had that...
Harry Reid.
Okay. It looks like the favorite son of Nevada is going to win this one. All right. Thanks a lot, sir. Have a great day.
Thank you very much, Peter.
Okay. Now, we've talked about this before, the sage-grouse plan. Now, the sage-grouse plan, you got officials in Elko, have appointed a pilot project designed to keep the sage-grouse off the endangered species list by killing ravens, by poisoning with poison eggs, and reducing wildfire fuel through livestock grazing. And this makes the most common sense. When they took, back in the late 90s, early 2000s, the BLM decided to take the cattle off the range. Well, what happens is you get a little bit of rain in the spring, all the grasses grow up. By June, you've got a lake of gasoline out there that you've got going on. When they took the livestock off, they shut down all your welder developments. It hurt the sage grouse. It hurt all wildlife. And you started having more fires than we ever had. We've covered this. We covered it quite a bit when this was going on, like in 2000, 2001. Now, Elko commissioners say that the program is set to begin on the 15,000 Devil's Gate Ranch and is needed because wildfire and ravens pose the biggest threat to the chicken-sized bird, that sage grouse. Now, Ted Koch, state supervisor for the Fish and Wildlife Service in Reno, agrees that wildfires and ravens are a factor in the bird's decline. He says Nevada alone has seen a 600% increase in scavengers over the past three decades. Tell you another thing, in southern Nevada, those ravens are the ones that are playing havoc with your desert turtle by eating the eggs or picking up the smaller turtles, flying them up, dropping them, and then landing on them and eating them. Now, sage-grouse population is estimated to have fallen 90% in the past century, even as cattle grazing has been systematically reduced by government regulators under pressure from absentee environmentalists. Once again, you've got your environmentalists. They come in. They make all kinds of comments. They have no idea what they're talking about. They've never been out on the range. They don't know what's going on out there. Now, this is the first private local government agreement designed to starve off the federal listing, the commissioner said. This is prompted by concerns that the listing of the large ground-dwelling bird could result in federal restrictions on grazing, mining, oil drilling, and other activities on public land, the real goal of many of the radical environmentalists. And I'm glad this article's calling it like it is. If the sage grouse goes on the endangered species list, we're going to lose most of northern Nevada, and we're going to lose it to, you know, we just started oil fracking. All of that will be gone. And that's what the environmentalists really are after. They just want to close it down. Now, grazing livestock reduces fuels on the range, the commissioners say, and they're absolutely right. The worst fire seasons on record have occurred after the government has sharply reduced grazing on public land in recent decades. Now, the Idaho-based Western Watershed Project, which actually called for the removal of the livestock, closing roads, and banning new oil and gas drilling, criticized the plan. What else is new? Their fixation on killing and poisoning native wildlife, turning the lands back to a dust bowl, is really twisted. They don't know what they're talking about. What these folks are doing up in Elko, and we're going to have more on it, is what they need to do. They need to open up the range, and they do need to do some predator control, and your birds will come back up. Now, Dean Heller is going to be working on this. He's trying to get the feds to work with the local states to make this more of a local issue than a one-size-fits-all coming out of Washington. Now, we're going to go to break. When we come back from break, we'll have the Ronald Reagan Report.
Jumping on a trampoline can leave you thirsty, but most drinks out there are high in calories and low in vitamins and minerals and lack a very important thing. The power behind the play. Milk from your local dairyman gives you that power. Low-fat and fat-free milk are naturally nutrient-rich, keeping you healthy and fit. So after all that jumping, ask for quality, icy-cold local milk from your local dairyman. It's the power behind the play. Visit DairyCouncilUTNV.org.
I've spoken several times about the price we may pay for what we've done to muzzle the FBI and the CIA. Now the bills are coming in. I'll be right back.
We live in uncertain times. To survive these times, we must be prepared. Those who prepare and stock up will be better able to live through whatever rough spots may be ahead. For this reason, Peter's asked me to introduce a new sponsor to the show. It's The Barrel Company at 1023 George Avenue in North Las Vegas. The Barrel Company is more than just a sponsor. They provide an essential need. The Barrel Company carries barrels for all your water storage needs. They include pumps, food-grade metal containers, epoxy-coated barrels, plastic food-grade barrels, and buckets for all these. Best of all, they're all in stock. So whatever your needs are, from food and water storage to storing guns and ammo, or putting together that 72-hour kit, the Barrel Company can help you. Stop by the Barrel Company up in North Las Vegas at 1023 George Avenue. Their phone number there is 642-7785. Once again, that's 642-7785. Or visit their website at www.barrel-company.com.
Some time ago on these broadcasts, I deplored the extent to which our government, yielding to pressure from a number of groups best described as bleeding hearts, had reduced the crime-fighting ability of the FBI and the counter-espionage ability of the CIA. I also told of how Philip Agee, ex-CIA agent turned Marxist, was going to be allowed to return to the United States with a promise from the Justice Department of immunity from prosecution. A late bulletin on him. He's evidently doing a new book or has done it already. The Soviet news agency TASS says Agee will name all the organizations and persons that were connected with U.S. intelligence services in the past 30 years. That could be quite an extensive execution list. But that isn't what I set out to tell you about today. An agency such as the FBI may spend years setting up an undercover agent in an inside position where he can gather evidence and information on a crime ring or specific criminal operation. The agent so set up is, in a way, really set up. If he's by any chance exposed, he may pay with his life. At the very least, all his work is wasted, and the crime hunt must begin all over if it can begin at all. Here is the story of Robert Cassidy, FBI undercover agent. Don't worry, I'm not blowing his cover. That's already been done by the United States Justice Department under which the FBI operates. Cassidy had successfully infiltrated a shipping company in Miami. He was gathering a wealth of material having to do with waterfront corruption in Miami and New York. It was possibly the biggest and most successful undercover investigation in shipping history. But it seems that a previous city assignment, a kind of peripheral one, was in connection with the FBI's look into the Socialist Workers' Party activities, a Trotskyite radical group. The grand jury is investigating the FBI conduct of this operation to see if any of the rights of the Trotskyites had been violated. Since Cassidy's role in that case had been a very minor one, the FBI proposed that he give a deposition, a sworn written statement concerning his part. The Justice Department said absolutely not. Agent Cassidy would appear in person in open court. And thus the Justice Department, guardians of our safety, ended the investigation into waterfront corruption, which had been proceeding so superbly, by blowing the carefully arranged cover and revealing Robert Cassidy to the world of crime as an undercover agent of the FBI. It is almost incomprehensible that anyone, least of all the chief law enforcement agent of the entire nation, could so confuse priorities. But that's the way it is in the wondrous wasteland of the Potomac. This is Ronald Reagan. Thanks for listening.
Scoring touchdowns can leave you thirsty, but most drinks out there are high in calories and low in vitamins and minerals and lack a very important thing. The power behind the play. Milk from your local Dairymen gives you that power. Low-fat and fat-free milk are naturally nutrient-rich, keeping you healthy and fit. So after the big touchdown, ask for quality, icy-cold local milk from your local Dairymen. It's the power behind the play. Visit DairyCouncilUTNV.org.
There's nothing like going hunting, whether it's a big game hunt of a lifetime or just a local bird hunt with close friends. Hunts never last as long as you want them to, and when the hunt is over, the only thing that's left is the memory of that hunt. So to preserve those memories, you mount your game, and every time you look at that mount, it takes you back to that hunt, and you remember every detail of it. That's why, with all the time and effort that you put into your hunt and getting that trophy, you deserve the best taxidermy possible. Here in Southern Nevada, that means Scott at Great Basin Taxidermy. Scott can do head and shoulder mounts, rugs, full body mounts, mounts in natural habitat. He also does birds, fish, and small game mounts. So when you need a taxidermist, call Scott at Great Basin Taxidermy. That's 368-1848. That number again is 368-1848. That's Great Basin Taxidermy at 3894 West Spring Mountain Road. Great Basin Taxidermy, creating hunting memories in Southern Nevada since 1988.
The phone lines are open. Call Peter now at 702-257-5396.
Welcome back to the show. Now, you just heard the new sponsor, the Barrel Company. If you want to get a hold of them, give them a call at 642-7785. You can go to their website at www.barrelcompany.com. Now, they've been in business since 1995, and I'll tell you one thing. You could also go to ruralnevadatoday.com, go to our sponsors list, click on the sponsors list, and you got a direct link to the Barrel Company. So once again, all you got to do is remember ruralnevadatoday.com, go to sponsors, and you can look up anything that you want to do with them. Now, we're going to do a story, and if I don't finish the story is by David Koppel, research director of the Independence Institute. Now, a lot of people go and say that the Boston Tea Party was the start of the American Revolution. Now, the Boston Tea Party took place in 1773. That was not the start. And this is something that's important. At that time, the colonists were upset about taxes that were being passed. They were upset about the Stamp Act tax that was being put on. The colonists went onto the boat. They broke the lock. They took the tea and threw it overboard as a protest. But it was a civil protest. The colonists responsible later paid for the damage done to the boat. They also paid for the tea. They felt at that time in 1773, they felt that they were loyal British citizens. Now, when you hear the liberals talk about the founding fathers not knowing about the guns of today, and this, they would have never gone with the Second Amendment had they known, it was because of British gun control that the revolution started. Now, this article, like I say, is by David Koppel. This reviews the British gun control program that precipitated the American Revolution. In 1774, import bans on firearms and gunpowder and the 1774-1775 confiscation of firearms and gunpowder, and the use of violence for these confiscations were the events that changed the situation and the political tension into a shooting war. Each of these British abuses provided insight into the scope of the modern Second Amendment and why we really have the Second Amendment. Now, furious at the December 1773 Boston Tea Party, the Parliament in 1774 passed the Coercive Act, and the particular provisions of that act were offensive to Americans, but it was the possibility that the British might deploy the army to enforce them that primed many of the colonists to arm resistance. The Patriots of Lancaster, Pennsylvania, resolved that in the event of British attempts to force unjust laws upon us by the strength reprinted in Virginia, urged that any law that had to be enforced by military was unnecessarily legitimate. Think about the drones today. Now, the royal governor of Massachusetts, General Thomas Gage, had forbidden town meetings from taking place more than once a year. He dispatched redcoats to break up illegal town meetings in Salem. 3,000 armed Americans appeared in response. The British retreated. Gage's aide, John Adams, explained that everybody in the area, age 16 years and older, owned a gun and had plenty of powder. Military rule would be difficult to impose on an armed population. Gage only had 2,000 troops in Boston. There were many thousands of armed men in Boston alone and more in the surrounding area. One response to the problem was to deprive the Americans of gunpowder. Why to make mention of this? What's going on today? Homeland Security wants to buy more than 1.6 billion rounds of ammunition over the next 4 to 5 years. Here's how it's going down. ICE has requested 450 million rounds of 40 caliber ammunition, 40 rounds of rifle ammunition, 176,000 rounds in a separate contract, 25,000 blank rounds. Homeland Security ammo is not the first time government bullet purchases have sparked concerns over the internet. The same thing happened. The Social Security Administration posted a notice that it was buying 174,000 hollow point bullets. That's the Social Security, the people who pay you your retirement fund. Why do they need hollow point bullets? It's a form of confiscation. They're taking the guns, just like the one caller we had last week said that they don't have to outlaw guns, they just have to get rid of the ammo. So here you have the British were trying to deprive in 1774 the Americans of gunpowder, which was the ammo of the day. Now, modern smokeless gunpowder is stable under most conditions. Black powder of the 18th century was far more volatile. Now, accordingly, large quantities of black powder were often stored in the town's powder house. Typically, it was a reinforced brick building. The powder houses were where merchants held their reserves. Large quantities were stored by individuals. You can go there and put your ammo in. It was where you stored your powder so your cabin wouldn't blow up, okay? Although colonial laws generally required militiamen and sometimes all householders, too, to have their firearms and munitions a minimum quantity of powder, not everybody could afford it. Consequently, the government sometimes provided public arms and powder to individual militiamen. Policies varied on whether militiamen would be given public arms to keep at home. Public arms were often stored in a special armory, which might also be house where the gunpowder house was. Now, before dawn of September of 1774, 260 of Gage's redcoats sailed up the Majestic River and seized hundreds of barrels of powder from Charleston's powder house. Now, the powder alarm, as it became known, was a serious problem. By the end of the day, 20,000 militiamen had mobilized and started marching towards Boston. In Connecticut and in western Massachusetts, rumors quickly spread that the powder alarm had actually involved fighting in the streets of Boston. More accurately, reports reached militia companies before the militia could even reach Boston, And so the war did not begin in September. The message, though, was unmistakable. If the British used violence to seize arms and powder, the Americans would treat that violent seizure as an act of war and would fight. And that is exactly what happened several months later, April of 1775. Once again, how did that revolution start? Over gun control. 5 days after the powder alarm on September 6th, the militia in the town of Westchester County assembled on the Westchester Commons. Backed by a formidable array, the Westchester Convention took over the reins of government and ordered the resignations of all militia officers who had received their commissions from the royal governor. The officers promptly resigned and then received their new commission from the Westchester Convention. They became an American army at that time. That same day, the people of Sussex County, which includes Boston, assembled and adopted the Suffolk Reserve. 19-point military resolution complained about the powder alarm and took control of the local militia away from the royal governor by replacing the governor's appointed officers with officers elected by the militia, and resolved to engage the group in practices with arms at least weekly. The First Continental Congress, which was assembled in Philadelphia, unanimously endorsed the Suffolk's resolution and urged that all colonies to send supplies to Bostonians. Governor Gage directed the Redcoats to begin a general, warrantless search for arms and ammunition. According to the Boston Gazette, all of Gage's offenses and what most irritated people was seizing arms and ammunition. I want to repeat, that was the seizing of their arms and ammunition. Think about that for a minute. When the Boston Assembly reconvened, General Gage declared it illegal, so representatives reassembled as a provincial Congress, and on October 26, 1774, the Boston Provincial Congress adopted resolutions condemning military rule and criticizing Gage as unfairly seizing and retaining large quantities of ammunition in the arsenal in Boston. The Provincial Congress urged all militia companies to organize, elect their own officers, at least a quarter of the militia, the famous Minutemen, were directed to equip and hold themselves in readiness to march at the shortest notice. The Provisional Congress further declared that anyone who did not already have a gun should get one and start practicing it with diligence. The flagrant defiance of the royal authority, the Provincial Congress appointed a committee of safety and vested it with the call to call forth militia. The militia of the Massachusetts was now an instrument of what had was becoming an independent government of Massachusetts. Lord Dartmouth, the Royal Secretary of State for America, sent Gage a letter in October 1774 urging him to disarm New England. Gage reported that he would like to do so, but it was impossible without the use of force. After Gage's letter was made public by a reading in the House of Commons, it was publicized in America as proof of Britain's intentions. 2 days after Lord Dartmouth dispensed his disarmament recommendation, King George III and his ministers blocked the importation of arms and ammunition. Once again, just like what they're doing today by buying up all of the ammunition that the civilian population here in America now buys, the King of England said, we are no longer going to export arms and ammunition into America. What happened was, in the meantime, Benjamin Franklin, great diplomat that he was, had masterminded the importation. He cut a deal with the Netherlands, France, and Spain. We were getting our arms and ammunition from the Netherlands, France, and Spain. A patriotic Boston Committee of Correspondence learned of the arms embargo and promptly dispatched Paul Revere to New Hampshire with the warning that two British ships were headed to Fort William Mary near Portsmouth, New Hampshire, to seize arms, cannons, and gunpowder. Once again, when the liberals talk about they only had muzzleloaders, that's exactly what the British had. But here we have not only the muzzleloaders, but we had the cannons also that were in private ownership. Try owning a cannon today in the United States. But at that time, when they're saying about the people not knowing what was going to happen with the types of guns we're having, they were on par with the British Empire. A New Hampshire newspaper urged the capture of prudent and proper, reminding the readers of the ancient Carthaginians' consent to deliver up their arms to the Romans, and then were decimated by the Romans. Yeah, you're a slave. When you give up your arms, you then become a slave. In Parliament, a moderate minority favored, they wanted to reconcile with America. Among the moderates was the Duke of Manchester. Now, he warned that America now had 3 million people, and most of them were trained to use firearms. He was certain that they could produce a stronger army than Britain could. The Massachusetts Provincial Congress offered to purchase as many arms and bayonets as they could be delivered to the next session of Congress. Massachusetts also urged American gunsmiths to diligently apply themselves to making guns for everyone who did not already have a gun. In the early weeks, the Congress resolved it would be strongly recommended that all inhabitants of the county be diligent and attentive in learning to use firearms. Once again, you're going to own a firearm? Get some education. This is exactly what the founding fathers intended. It was to keep the Second Amendment. It didn't have anything to do about hunting. I'm a guy who likes to hunt and what have you, but the Second Amendment's not about my hunting rights. It's about keeping the populace free from tyranny. I'll tell you what, while we're talking about being able to buy guns, don't forget the Second Amendment Gun Shop. Now, they're located at 4570 North Rancho. He had a chance to talk with Mark last night. They've got all kinds of ammo. He says they even have the hard stuff. So that right now, if you're looking to buy ammo, you haven't had a chance to get the ammo, you want to go up to Second Amendment Gun Shop. They're at 4570 North Rancho. They're right across the street from Big Dogs. You can go in and get the ammo. We're going to have to take a break now, and when we get back from break, we'll continue with this.
I like baseball. I love milk. My milk's low in calories and high in vitamins and minerals. My milk comes from cows in beautiful Nevada. Cows and milk are the power behind the play.
Icy cold local milk from your local dairyman gives you that power. Low-fat and fat-free milk are naturally nutrient-rich.
Baseball and milk keep me healthy and fit.
Quality, icy cold, local milk from your local dairyman.
The power behind the play.
Nestled on the Nevada-California border in the Sandy Valley sits Two Hawk Ranch. Surrounded by thick, lush fields of locally grown alfalfa, Two Hawk Ranch has bulk and cubes available. If you have not tried alfalfa cubes, let the good folks at Two Hawk Ranch explain to you the value of feeding your horses cubes, and you decide which of these great products you wish to feed your animal. Horse and livestock owners, with a great supply of locally grown alfalfa, where you can buy direct from the owner. Why would you buy from anyone else? Call Jared or Kale at 702-723-5375. That number again, 702-723-5375. Or drive out the Sandy Valley and follow the signs. You'll be able to see the green fields of Two Hawk Ranch long before you get there. Two Hawk Ranch, they'll always treat you right. If you want to advertise during this show, call Peter at 882-2865. That's 882-2865.
Well, welcome back to the show. Now, if anybody's got any calls or comments, give me a call at 257-5396. I'm doing something today that I normally hate doing because I think it's boring as can be. It's reading to you. Now, I've read to you 2.5 pages of an 8-page story. This is what really happened. It's historic. I don't think that reading anymore is going to do anything for you. If you want, I think everybody should read this, but read it on your own. It's 8 pages long. It's dates. It's history. It's by David Koppel, K-O-P-E-L. It's The American Revolution Against British Gun Control. And when you hear all the way these liberals always want to rewrite history, once again, I want to tell you, it had everything to do with guns. Well, they say, you know, the founding fathers, they didn't know the type of guns we were going to have. Yeah, they they didn't know. Nobody can look 300 years in the future and know what you're going to have. How could I predict what's going to happen 250 years from now? Nobody can. But the fundamental was the same. The American Revolution was fought to free the colonists from tyranny. And while they were protesting, they were talking about things in their town meetings, the colonial congresses were trying to get a better deal so we wouldn't get taxed so much, much like what your politicians do today. They go in and they talk about things, and they would send things off to London and hope that the king would respond. And they felt that they were loyal British subjects. They felt loyalty to the king. They felt loyalty to all of his people here. It was when they tried to seize the guns from the colonists that the colonists got rid of the king's appointed people and commissioned them through their own ranks, and they became American militiamen. And what was the catalyst? What started the actual shooting? It was the gun control. Be careful what goes on today. In history, we learn this lesson constantly. Seen it in Nazi Germany, seen it in the Soviet Union, seen it in communist China. I read you a passage from a book about the Nazis who had gone into Argentina after World War II, and they were starting to put together what they felt would be the continuation of the Third Reich. And they were appalled by the fact that the Argentine people had guns. And they talked about this is why the Fuhrer had thought it was so important that the population should not have guns. They talked, these were SS people, former SS people who were trying to get this organization going, and they couldn't get it going because you had an armed population. They had brought guns with them at the end of World War II. They still had many of their guns and things that they had from the war, and they wanted to start a continuation of the Third Reich. And they couldn't do it because of the armed population. Japan, at the end of the world, or at the beginning of World War II, when they bombed Pearl Harbor, there was nothing standing in their way from landing on the West Coast. They could have actually marched all the way to the Mississippi River. There was nothing there until they hit Chicago. We had no military to stop them. The Japanese did not invade. They did not invade the West Coast, even though we were in fear of it. After World War II, it came out that the Japanese would not invade the United States because all of the citizens owned guns. And they knew that they would be facing millions of people, millions of armed people, and they felt that they were going to get into a war that they couldn't win. So they wanted to bomb us into submission. They thought that they could get an armistice out of us. But as far as invading the continental United States, Japan could have been here by January of 1942. Once again, armed civilians stopped them. They knew what they were coming into. You've got people that are trying to put on gun control. They do this every time there's a tragedy. But do you notice how many shootings now are being reported? Every time there's a shooting, it now becomes national news, where normally it would have just been on local news. But all of a sudden, there's an overwhelming number of shootings. Why? It works to this administration to say, oh, my God, we've got to do something. We've got to do something. Well, it's fallen flat on its face. We talked last week about how they pulled the assault rifle ban out of the new gun legislation. It's getting watered down. It's getting made weaker. You've still got to be vigilant. Don't let this go. Ask yourself the question, why do they want to take our arms away from us? No good comes of an unarmed population. You know, it is time to stand up, vote for people who are going to let you keep your guns. You vote for the people against the people who want to take them away. Every dictatorship started, and look what is going on today. When a dictatorship starts, the first thing they do is they get rid of the guns. They ration out medicine. We've now got Obamacare coming at the end of this year. But you don't have an independent place to go for medicine. You have to depend on the government. two or the third thing that they do, and it happens every time, and it affects us here in rural Nevada. It affects all of the rural United States. You get into a situation where they control the food supply. Now, we're being told in New York what size pop you can buy. They're going after and saying that these foods are bad because, you know, we've got national health care coming in, so you can't have it. So more and more, they're putting themselves in the food supply. You won't have a gun. They'll control your medicine, and they'll control your food. You'll be totally dependent on them, and the dictatorship starts. Keep that in mind when you go through these things. We're going to go to break. When we come back from break, we'll wrap it up.
Scoring touchdowns can leave you thirsty, but most drinks out there are high in calories and low in vitamins and minerals and lack a very important thing. The power behind the play. Milk from your local Dairyman gives you that power. Low-fat and fat-free milk are naturally nutrient-rich, keeping you healthy and fit. So after the big touchdown, ask for quality, icy-cold local milk from your local Dairyman. It's the power behind the play. Visit DairyCouncilUTNV.org.
Is your car's radiator leaking? Does your cooling system need some attention? And with this economy, have you been putting it off? Not doing routine maintenance can end up costing you many more dollars down the road. So if it's been a while since you've had your car's cooling system serviced, or if you're looking for a real radiator shop that can answer your questions, then it's time to stop by Cool Radiator at 3228 West Mead Avenue and let Daryl have a look at your radiator. Daryl will be able to answer all of your questions and explain just how your cooling system works. The good folks at Cool Radiator understand your concerns, and they can help. So stop stressing out and stop by Cool Radiator and get some of the small problems fixed before they turn into something major. That's Cool Radiator at 3228 West Mead Avenue, east of Valley View, between Sahara and Dion.
If you want to advertise during this show, call Peter at 882-2865. That's 882-2865.
Well, that's it for this week's show. We got to wrap it up. And like I say, the piece is a very important piece. Google the American Revolution against British gun control. It's an article by David Koppel, K-O-P-E-L. Now, he is the research director for the Independence Institution. Learn your history. Learn the history of this country. It's a great history. And, you know, you've got so many revisionists. What our kids are told today is that we were picking on the Japanese after Pearl Harbor. Everything is turned around that we were the ones, we were the aggressor. We're the only country that goes in, conquers a country, and releases it, turns it right back over to the civilian population, changes the government, and gives them everything back. We don't keep territory. The only territory we've ever kept is the graveyards of our American soldiers that went and liberated those countries. We've never kept the territory. We've never kept oil rights. You know, maybe some of it's stupid. We fought the war in Iraq, and China got the oil. I don't know how smart that was, but, you know, so be it. I mean, sometimes I think we should get something out of it. The other point, tomorrow is one of the holiest, is the holiest day of the year. I think it ranks over Christmas. It's Easter. Now, our culture, our religion, it's under assault. In Alabama this past week, they're no longer calling, and one of the schools are no longer calling the rabbit a Easter rabbit or an Easter bunny. He's now a holiday bunny. We went over this at Christmas time about how I wouldn't send out Christmas cards unless they said Merry Christmas. Practice your religion. Don't be ashamed of it. There is a good story. It's called The Bible. It's going to be on the History Channel. Roma Downey and her husband put it together. They're going to have the final episode tomorrow. Watch it. Take the time to watch it. Enjoy your holiday tomorrow, and remember who you are. We'll talk again next week.
There must be some kind of way out of here. Say the joker to the thief. There's too much confusion. I can't get no relief. Businessman there.
plowman, dig my earth.